Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 53 for the 14th of August, 2022. I want to start out this week by going through the mailbag. Past couple of weeks, I've fallen kind of behind on some correspondence, both from email and from comments on YouTube videos. So I picked out some of the highlights and printed them out and figured we could attack them here. So Michael writes, and this was a comment on the Singer 15-91 bobbin winder adjustment video. He goes, "Are there different sizes of bobbin tires? Because the original tire was much larger than the Singer Belt and Tire Replacement Pack I bought. The machine is a 1932 15-91. Well, I hate to say this, but the answer is yes and no. There's a specification for the tire, but not all of the makers of the tires these days exactly conform to that specification. Fortuitously, there should be plenty of adjustment in a 1591's bobbin winder to get it to work properly. I find some of the tires I find are really, really fat, some not quite as much. The inside diameters are pretty consistent. Well, depends on how they measure them, I guess. But yeah, some of them are made a little fatter than others. I tend to buy mine in bulk. I buy a bag of 100 tires at a time, usually either through one of the companies like Sewing Parts Online or Central Michigan Sewing Supplies. But yeah, you know, you're going to find a bunch of stuff. The last time I bought one of those Singer stretchy belt things that comes with a bobbin winder tire, the stretchy belt was dried out and the bobbin winder tire had a crack in it, so I don't even bother with those. Moving right along, Berkley Pearl it was a comment on the 1591 Libs, Sunday Morning Quickies, May 22nd of 2022. She writes, "I just purchased a 1941 Treadle Singer 15 and I'm so excited to get it working. Before I fully started disassembling it, I wanted to test out its function. It was last in use about a year ago and has since become rather dusty and rusty, but has been basically untouched. When I disengage the needle, the treadle runs like butter. However, when I engage the needle, the belt gets stuck and stops spinning, and then the treadle jams. Do you suppose it just needs a good cleaning to start working again, or is there something else I might be missing? I plan on watching all of these videos tomorrow so that I can carefully as possible follow along with cleaning her to the best of my ability." Well, considering it's been sitting for a year, it's going to need at least a good cleaning and lube. I would get chip brush or two. This one's an inch wide, a half inch wide is also handy. I would get in there and I would get every little bit of dust and lint out before applying any oil. You might want to grab some tweezers as well. Some little bent nose tweezers are great for going in and grabbing little schmutzies out. But get as much dirt and lint out of the machine before you apply oil. And I also recommend, you can get these type of oil, these little bottles with the needle spouts. You can get these all over the place. I know they sell, well, you can buy them online, but they also sell them at Hobby Lobby, too. Don't go using the big Zoom spout oilers. You're just going to make a mess. Get your oil in a larger quantity and dispense it into one of those little 1 ounce bottles with the needle thing. And you can put controlled drops of oil exactly where you need them. But yeah, I think you just need a good dust out and oiling, more than likely. That's a good start anyway. I love this username. Anonymous Amy wrote a comment on the Singer 201-2 Rewire Part 1. "For someone who knows absolutely nothing about wiring or electrical stuff, What kind of wire do I need to buy to rewire my 201-2 motor and light? Is there a specific type slash gauge I need? Well, Amy, I use this stuff. Let me find the right drawer here. I use Stinger Select in 18 gauge, but then again, this is a, how big is that spool? It's got to be at least 250-foot spool. You're not going to need that much. Honestly, if you don't have any experience with wiring and electrical work, I would suggest getting some, learning how to solder first on something other than your sewing machine motor. If you have a local electronics supply store, like I hear near me, a couple of towns down the road in Hazlitt, New Jersey, I've got Interstate Electronics Supply. They stock a wide variety of wires and supplies and stuff like that. You'll want to learn how to use a soldering iron, and you'll learn how to use it properly. You'll want to learn how to strip wire properly. It's real easy to make a complete and total mess out of a motor. On my bench right now, I have the motor from a 101 that a customer had sent me, and that individual took the motor apart and started cutting wires and kind of got in over their head, and now I've got a motor here with a field coil that I can't attach new wires to because of where it was cut. Fortuitously, I have another 101 motor that had a bad rotating mass in it that had a short in it, so I'll be able to take the armature from the new customer's motor and put that, once I clean it up, put that into the other core of a motor I have once I rewire it. But yeah, it's so super simple to damage and ruin one of those potted motors. There's a bunch of us out there. I'm not the only one. There's a bunch of people who offer services for rewiring them. Amy, I wholeheartedly recommend learning how to do basic soldering, you know, getting some basic soldering and electronic skills. Even though it's an electrical item, technically, you want to be able to have some electronic skills, not like electrician house wiring type skills. So I know that might not be the greatest answer you've ever heard, nor the one you expected, but that's my story. I'm going to stick to it. Randall writes on troubleshooting a stuck 66. Excuse me, Ryan Randall writes. Sorry about that, Ryan. Hey, Bob, thanks for the video. Lots of good information. I have a Model 66 that was given to me, but it's pretty rusty inside. After an hour or so of spraying with penetrating oil and fixing the washer on the wheel that needed to be flipped around, I got everything moving pretty well, but it still binds up in one little spot. I don't want to take it all apart, but I really want to clean up the rust on the internal parts. Is there any way I can clean up that stuff without taking it all apart? I appreciate any advice. Thanks, man. Well, Ryan, I hate to say this, but it ain't clean enough, because unless there's something bent, that, you know, sticking in one little tiny spot, that could be a bent needle bar. Probably isn't. It's probably a little bit of dirt someplace that's messing with you. If you followed the directions on troubleshooting a stuck 66, you know how I said disengage the pitman arm to the bottom linkages first to isolate the top from the bottom of the machine. If the top is spinning freely with the bottom disengaged, then the dirt problem is on the bottom. If it's up top, then you're going to have to get a little bit deeper into it. My guess is it's probably something down below, but not having the machine in front of me. But as I mentioned to Berkley Pearl, cleanliness, cleanliness, cleanliness. Now, I know you already shot an inordinate amount of penetrating oil into it, so it's probably dripping pretty good at this point. But your option at this point really is to get in there with tweezers and look for crud. Crud can form in some of the strangest places that will slow you down. For example, I've seen a lot of machines, especially 66 classes, as a matter of fact, where it seems like there's a little bump someplace when the machine arrives. Take the needle plate off, find out that there was dirt around the feed dogs, so that it was interfering with the feed dogs and the needle plate, or the feed dog, that whole mechanism. That's kind of common as well. But yeah, you're going to have to go on a dirt hunting expedition, so, you know, let me know how you make out, but I think you'll be okay. Jewelie Schultz writes, as a comment to the Singer 201, remove and replace the bobbin case and hook. Great video. I'm having issues with getting the ring back in place. Only one side will go under the spring. The other side, there's not enough clearance for the spring to slide up the ramp onto the ring. I've checked the placement a bunch of times and it seems okay. The issue seems to be that the spring sits low. Maybe the top was bent down. How can I resolve this? Well, Jewelie, if you have the hook out, you can play with the retaining ring with the hook out and see if that is in fact the problem. I kind of doubt it. Usually they don't, unless it was abused or got banged by something, I usually don't see too many of the retaining springs getting bent. It's actually pretty rare. Keep in mind, you only have to line up the one side that's got the little hook and then the other side is the ramp. Just line the hook up so that the half moon shape is around that spring, then the other ramp will line up, and put even pressure down on both ends of the retaining ring and then just push it through, and it should get underneath both sides of the spring. Worst case scenario, send me some pictures or shoot a video with your cell phone and send it to me. You know, I was in post-production editing this video, and I realized, you know, I have an extra hook and retainer and bobbin case for a 201 here, and maybe just showing this outside of the machine might be even easier to see. So here we have the hook assembly, and now the bobbin case is going to be sitting in thusly, and this little tab is going to be engaged into the bobbin case positioning bracket, but let's get that out of the way and just worry about getting the retaining ring on. All right, you see we have the spring clip here, and 180 degrees out we have the spring clip here. Let's look at the retaining ring. This is the horseshoe, or the curved cutout, and here's the ramp. Now this is not the cleanest parts in the world. These are straight out of my parts bin. I did clean a little bit of it off, but not much. So, with the bobbin case in and properly latched into the positioning bracket, I'm going to take that off so you can see, you're going to want to place that cutout area so it's inside where that spring is, and this ramp is going to be at the approach. It's going to be just starting to go at the clip here on the bottom. So, now with just a little bit of gentle pressure, I'm doing this just by hand, then it will click in. So, yeah, you can do it. If these springs are bad, I mean, they're two separate springs. They're held on by screws. I guess if the spring had an issue, you could... here, let me disengage this and get that off. If I can do this without stabbing myself. You could possibly, if these are bent, you could take the screw off, remove the part, and if you have some small needle nose pliers, you could properly get this into the proper angles again and then screw it back together. But really, that's all there is to it, is to find, get the dirt out of there, get the appropriate portions lined up, get good pressure down, and then slide it in. And there it goes. It clicks right in place. Okay, Eugene Slagle from email writes, first off, thanks for the advice on my 1912 Singer 66. I have recently acquired a 1946 model 128 and now a 1962 Singer model 185. I'm restoring the 128 and and being the 185 sews beautifully, it currently will be my primary sewing machine. My other acquired machine is a Brother VX710, which has a missing belt, but otherwise seems to be working by hand. Would you know of a place that would have a proper belt for the Brother VX710, and possibly where I could also have spare parts for the 128 and 185? My goal is to get the Brother functioning, and if the church crafters don't want it, sell it and use the proceeds for the church youth. Well, Eugene, it just so happens, I took a look, and sewing parts online indicates that the VX710 uses a 21-inch belt, and they have a cogged one available for $11.99. It's part number 130944-001. If you go to their website, search for that number, you'll be all set. But what I'll also do is I'll put a link down below in the doobly-doo for you. Just click on it, you can go buy it. That's not a problem. As far as parts for the 128 and the 185, both those machines have been out of production so long, you are not going to find, well, odds are you're not going to find new parts. And it's like I tell everybody, you know, develop a relationship with people who part out machines on eBay on a fairly regular basis. eBay is your friend. In this case, I would search Singer 128 parts and Singer 185 parts. Fortuitously, a lot of the parts on a 185 are the same as a 99, and some are even the same as a 66. 128, there is some commonality with a 127, although not as much as there is for the 99 to the 185. But yeah, you're going to have to do like the rest of us and go searching the used part universe. Welcome to my world. Before we go any farther, let me clarify. When I said you can't get new parts, I was referring to hard parts such as rock shafts, connecting rods, etc. A lot of these older machines, there are plenty of parts still available. They're just not going to be brand new Singer-made parts. You can get upper thread tension assemblies, many times feed dogs, all sorts of what I will call consumable parts, the heavy wear parts. Those are readily available. Here's another one from email. Brenda Sheaffer writes, "Hi Bob. First of all, thank you for making your great videos. I'm a novice at working on vintage machines and your videos are so helpful." Well, thank you very much, Brenda. "I've only worked on the Singer featherweights. My brother recently bought a house and found a 1935 Singer 99 in the garage. It's a mess, but I'm hoping to get it running again. The wheel wouldn't budge and neither will the needle bar. I've been using penetrating oil and Q-tips dipped in alcohol to glean the old dried oil and gunk off. Nothing works. Most of the screws are so tight it's like they were put in with an impact driver, and I'm afraid of damaging them. I've removed what I can, but the needle bar is stuck about midway, so I can't access the screws to remove those parts. Any suggestions? Is there a way to remove the housing to get access to the main shaft? I hate to give up on the old girl. She's been neglected for decades and obviously mistreated badly. Someone even took a needle or something and scribed a phrase on the bed, evidently in frustration when trying to fix her. Any suggestions you have would be greatly appreciated." Brenda, you can email me what that phrase was. I'm really curious. Anyway, first and foremost, lose the alcohol. Alcohol on vintage sewing machines that does not mix. If it gets on the exterior of the machine, it will screw up the finish. So get rid of the alcohol. Also, not all penetrating oils are created equal. Longtime viewers will know that I'm a huge fan of the Croil products, be it either the liquid Croil or the aerosol AeroCroil. Now, I know there's a lot of penetrating oils out there. AeroCroil is my penetrant of choice. A lot of people don't like the smell. I was a smoker for a lot of years. I lost a lot of my sense of smell. I've never found it offensive. But what I will say is, it might be time to, and I don't know what you've got for tools, but if you are using a Chapman screwdriver set, now the Chapman, these are hollow ground bits. They're available in sets. You can also buy additional bits from right off Chapman's website. I buy certain ones. I buy a dozen or so at a time. Because the beautiful thing about these bits is they are engineered and designed to fail before the fastener does. So these are great. If you get the kit, you'll have the extension that the bit goes to, and then it goes into the handle. But the kits, many of the kits also include this little ratcheting handle. So, for example, you can have your bit in your hand and your in your extension, put the ratchet on, then put your handle on top, and now you've got something where you can give good, firm, downward pressure on the fastener, and now you have a lever you can use to get some extra oomph to break it free. Now, it's also important to choose the correct size bit for the screw head. I can't emphasize that enough, getting the correct size screw head. Now, one thing you won't be able to do with the Chapmans is you won't be able to get, even once you get that needle bar down into its lowest position, you're not going to get through the hole in the back of the needle bar box where you access the screw that secures the needle bar to the needle bar clamp. You're going to need a different screwdriver for that. So, you know, like, this is the one I use. This is actually an old Craftsman. I think it's a 3 millimeter, and this is 40 millimeters long on the shaft, but it's 3 millimeters wide. This one goes in there, fits really nice. I also, depending upon the machine, I don't know what size this one is. That's another Craftsman screwdriver. It's a small one. It's one of the ones out of the sets. You're going to have to find the appropriate screwdrivers to get into certain things you cannot do with the Chapman sets. But having said that, you can use heat from a hairdryer along with your penetrating oil, and sometimes just putting a screwdriver into the slot. I use, I'm a big fan of using my plastic headed mallet. Put a screwdriver into the slot. Just give it a little rap. You don't have to go wailing on it. Just give it a little rap. And the shock being transmitted down from the head of the screwdriver down to the business end of the screwdriver sometimes is enough to break crud free. Because what you're experiencing is what I call crud welding. And it can be a bit of a challenge. Now, like I said, I'm a big fan of this stuff. Not a sponsor. Actually, all these things that I've mentioned today, I don't have sponsors. But this stuff, it's a bit expensive, but oh my god, does this work well. The AeroCroil, big fan of it. But yeah, you're going to have to find, if you want to resurrect that 99, it's going to take time, a little bit of heat. Don't go using a heat gun. You want to use that'll be too much. A hair dryer amount of heat is generally enough. Good penetrating oil like AeroCroil. Proper size, correct fitting screwdriver bits. That is so important. And like I said, you know, the Chapman ones, those are designed to break away so it won't screw up the head. So yeah, you might wind up spending a few dollars here and there buying a bunch more bits. But in the long term, it's worth it. Let me see what else. There was something else I wanted to mention on that. I mentioned, forget about using, housing to get to the main shaft. 99s, 66s, 15s, the vibrating shuttle machines, I do not recommend that people pull the main shafts out. 99 especially, the you need a special tool, which you would have to make, to drive out the bushing at the needle bar end, so you could get the main shaft out. The main shaft actually extracts out by the needle bar. The tool you need to make for that, it's not the most difficult to fabricate, but I mean, it's easier to do it on a 66 than a 99, but snaking it in there and getting it in the right place and then doing the whacking that's required, I just don't recommend it. And one of the reasons I don't recommend it is the vertical shaft in the 66 and the 99 machines, it's got like a cage built into it. And if you, I did one of the videos on my International Harvester Red 66. I had that one completely apart, and I show how putting that back together. But getting that apart, there is such a tremendous opportunity to break that cage-like portion of the vertical shaft. That's why I don't recommend people take that out. But other than that, I just say give it time. Give it penetrating oil, a little bit of heat, proper size screwdrivers. Kathleen Fitzgerald writes from email, "Hello, Bob. I'm so happy I found your YouTube channel." Well, I'm happy you found it, too. Wow, good info. "My great Aunt Cecilia's Singer 201-2 became mine in 1983 and has worked great for years. It now appears that the motor does not work. It does absolutely nothing when powered. I can barely turn the wheel to force it to move. I did take it to a local Singer repair place, and they said they needed a motor, but they did not have one, nor could they find one online. Is there a way to tell if it's the motor, or is there some other troubleshooting I could do myself? I'm not sure what to do next, and the local repair is not an option. My husband said that between the two of us, we could probably follow along a YouTube video, but we don't know exactly what the problem with the motor is. Thank you, Kathleen." Well, Kathleen, what I would do before looking to buy a new motor is I would take the motor off of the machine. If you look at part one of my Singer 201-2 motor series, I show how to remove the motor. There's two, you have to get the balance wheel off first, and there's two screws inside. If it's never been removed, they can be a little bit tricky to get off. You need a little bit of force. But once you get them off, put the balance wheel back on the machine and then turn the hand wheel through. Let's find out, let's isolate first to make sure that the problem is actually not in the machine, but it's in the motor. Once we know that, then we start worrying about getting the motor fixed. Potted motors on 201-2s are not that difficult to repair. Sometimes, though, I have seen some that are beyond. And if you've been using it a lot since 1983, and you didn't say what year this particular one was made, it might be at end of life, or it just might need a really good tear down, cleaning, and service. But it does trouble me that you say you can't force the hand wheel to move. So, I mean, it could be a problem with the Texalite gear on the hand wheel interfacing with the worm on the motor. There's all sorts of things it could be. So please, take the motor off first, put the balance wheel back on, make sure you put the stop motion washer and the knob on, and then try turning the machine over by hand, see what it does. Then get back to me. Email is down below, argosybob@gmail.com, or I think you sent this came to my Bob at bobsvsmservice.com, whatever. But just touch base with me again and let me know how you make out with that. Virginia Rodriguez writes via email, "Hi Bob, I found your YouTube channel last night and have been binge watching many of your videos since. Your tutorials are excellent." Thank you. "I've already learned so much from you. Thank you for doing this. It's a real lifesaver. I found this Made in Japan Deluxe Singer 15 clone at a garage sale last week for $10. It was in really sorry shape after being left in a garden shed here in our Ohio winters for decades. It was almost completely seized up and covered in soot and hardened oil. I managed to clean it up and get all the parts back in their proper places. Amazing. I also got new oil in the right parts. Now runs smoothly and appears to have promise. The motor is made in Belgium, type UV73, 1.0 amp, 115 volt. It says Belgel core on it. Runs beautifully, but I'm not sure if it needs oil. I do, however, have two problems. But before we get to the problems, some motors use oil, some motors use grease. I wouldn't worry about lubricating the motor just yet. Anyway, let's get to the problems. One, the feed dogs move when it runs, but do not have any effect on fabric below the foot. The fabric moves up and down a bit with the movement of the dog, but stays in the same position. There is sufficient pressure on the foot, and the stitch length regulator does not seem to have an effect on the length of the stitch or on reverse. Whatever the setting, it makes a really small stitch. This is my first vintage machine, so I'm a total newbie, and would love to hear from you on possible solutions. Also, if you think it's even worth putting any more money or time into it, thanks for any guidance you can share, Virginia. Well, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus. I'm sorry, I had to say that. Your problem is actually very, very simple. Let me get one of those machines, and I'll show you. Okay, Virginia, this one, too, is a deluxe, and I think I got about the same amount of money, about 10 bucks in it. And it's literally been sitting as a doorstop since I brought it home. I haven't had a chance to do it. So, yeah, there's going to be some cat hair on this. Anyway, bottom shaft, here's your feed dog rock shaft. This up here is your lifter shaft. What is happening with your machine? I can say this with 99.999999% certainty. If you're moving your stitch length regulator and it's not moving anything, it's just making a tiny, tiny, tiny stitch. When you cleaned it up and put it back together, this screw got moved. And because this right here is what adjusts the height of the feed dogs. Your feed dogs are not sticking through the needle plate enough. I can almost guarantee you that's what's happening. Everything else, as far as the feed mechanism goes, is completely mechanical linkage. There is no way you can have one of these machines and it just won't feed unless the feed dogs aren't going up and down correctly. And that is controlled here. That is the adjusting screw for it. What you'll want to do is get the rotate the hand wheel. I would put the presser bar up. Take the needle off, get it out of your way, but rotate the hand wheel so that the feed dog is up and in the middle of its travel, heading towards the back of the machine, and then you can stand the machine up or lay it down like this, whatever. Loosen that screw, and then you'll be able to move the mechanism it'll move the feed dogs. You can press here. And if you go too far, you can press the feed dogs to knock it down. But what you're aiming for is 80% of the height of the teeth to be above the surface of the needle plate. You get that, come back here with your screwdriver, lock that in. And that you don't have to crank it super hard, but get her nice and firm. I can almost guarantee that is your problem. Last but not least, certainly not least, speaking of Singer 101s, I mentioned one, the motor being worked on earlier. Same customer sent me a lighting unit to repair. Now, you've probably seen these Singers. Well, if you've seen a 101, you know it uses this style of light switch assembly that almost looks like it came out of a table lamp. They can be a bit of a challenge to get apart. So, watch this. I'm working on this light for a Singer 101 for a customer out of Wisconsin. Anyway, if you've ever taken one of these apart, these 101s are especially difficult. They're very, very tricky to get the shroud, the metal portion of the shroud that goes around the socket, to separate from the base. It involves getting screwdrivers in there, and eventually you kind of chowder this up a little bit. Here's a little trick you can use.
I've got a multitude of these beadsmith jewelry making pliers. You can use these and apply a little bit of pressure and get this nice and round again. And then before I reassemble this, after I know I've got it nice and round, and I've got several different sizes of these pliers, I can go through and just get any little denting that I might have imparted upon this in the disassembly process. I can get very close in, work it all out, get it nice, looking real nice, and then I can buff and polish this at the buffer before I reassemble the light unit, and it'll look really nice before it goes back to the customer. So that's just a little quickie that you might need to know someday. Here's another little trick. When the customer sent me the light and the motor for rewiring, she had cut the wires back down here, but I don't know how well you're going to be able to see this. See what Singer did here. They basically stripped the wire, spread it, and then they formed a loop and put it together. I'm going to show you how I'm going to recreate that. I'm going to mount up this punch in my little machinist vise and use this as a mandrel and do my forming on this. Now, I stripped this side back quite a bit, and I'm going to split the number of strands of the stranded wire so that it's pretty evenly divided. And I'm going to twist each set of them individually. Got one side twisted. Now I have the other side twisted. I guess that makes me a twisted person. And now I'm going to form it here, bring it around my mandrel, pull her tight, and twist her around just a couple of times. Alright, now I'm going to slide this up and off. I'm going to double check with my screw here, make sure the screw is going to fit okay. The screw is going to fit just fine. And now, I'll move this out of the way, grab my third hand, get that up in the third hand, grab my spool of solder. I'm going to use my gun for this instead of my really nice soldering station. Clean the tip off. We got some heat here. And now I'm just going to put a little solder on. I'm going to heat that wire up and get a little solder on the area where I twisted it around the other end, and then just move the soldering iron or the soldering gun around to get just a little bit of solder on that wire, just like that. Last but not least, I'll come back and I'll trim just to the top of the ring. I'll lather, rinse, repeat on the other side, and I will have effectively duplicated what Singer had done at the factory oh so many years ago.
Well, that's what I've got for you this week on Sunday Morning Quickies. A little bit of housekeeping information before we go. If you are going to be in New Jersey, October 29th, 2022, Liz and I will be at the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association Craft Fair, Makers Fair, whatever they're calling it, in Leonardo, New Jersey, just a few miles down the road from us. It's a great cause. There's going to be all sorts of crafters there. There's going to be musicians. There's going to be stuff for the kids. There'll be food vendors. There'll be all sorts of cool stuff. Liz and I are actually going to be there shooting photographs and some video that they can use for promos, but we'll be there all day supporting one of our favorite charities. So that's, like I said, October 29th, 2022, and there'll be a thing down in the doobly-doo for that, and you've been looking at a blurb already on screen. Also, if you haven't done so already, head on over to my friend Jen DeLeo's YouTube channel, Sewing Machine Rehab. She's been working on a series on the Singer 301 that is just absolutely fantastic. She did a really great job on a recent video where she put the motor back together for a 301, something that's not a lot of fun to do. But Jen does a great job, and she gets deep into the weeds on the machine videos that she does. So go on over, check out Jen's work, give her a subscription, thumbs up, all that kind of good stuff. Show some love to Jennifer. Let's see what else. Oh, yeah, there may or may not be a Sunday Morning Quickies coming up this coming week. Liz and I have to take care of some family legal business, which is going to involve trips to Pennsylvania and Massachusetts, and we don't know how this is going to work out, how much time is going to be away. So if there is a Sunday Morning Quickies, great. If not, please understand why. We got a lot of stuff to take care of. But anyway, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.